Hey everyone, Cromwell's here with, for the first time in a few years, a Warzone video. Taking a quick look at Warzone's new naval battles that should go into closed beta test soon. Since I do have an interest in naval warfare, I was always curious about how Warzone's approach to it would look like. After all, ships for the game were announced even before tanks a few years ago. However, when naval forces for Warzone were tested for the first time, it was only torpedo boats and similar small units blasting each other with lots of machine guns at short range, which honestly I was not that interested in. I want proper ships. And luckily, they were eventually added as well. First destroyers and then light cruisers, which are the biggest units in Warzone naval battles so far. So, after seeing that, when I watched videos of the test, I thought, count me in, and I got one of those packs that give access to the test, so I can try it myself in the next test, which we had over the weekend now. So, having the first opportunity to try it, and liking it for the most part, I thought I'd make a quick video and explain how it works a bit, and also give a few first impressions. After all, quite a few of my subscribers are Warzone players as well. And also compare a few elements of Warzone's approach to those ships, to World of Warships, which I have also played a fair bit. Mind you though, that the point of a few of those comparisons is not to claim that one or the other is better. The two games are far too different in my opinion for that, having a very different approach to things like realism for example. And if you like one or the other better, or both, like in my case, will depend mostly on your own preferences. However, when it comes to naval multiplayer games, there's little else to compare it to, which a lot of people will be familiar with. And also, since I expect quite a few World of Warships players will at least take a look at War Thunder, it might be useful to point out some differences and how some things will be the exact opposite in one game than they are in the other. Well then, let's take a look. The usual disclaimer first, this is in beta and everything is subject to change. Also, in this test so far there is arcade and realistic mode. I have exclusively played the realistic mode, since that is what I care about most, so all I say is exclusive to the realistic battle mode and might not apply in arcade. So, let's go over the basics. I don't think I have to say much about the graphics, you can see how it looks, and I would say it looks quite good. Mind you, my graphics settings for this test were the standard high preset. You could go higher than that, but I have noticed that ships seem to need a bit more power from your computer than ground forces or planes. I guess that's because the large amount of weapons on the larger ships blasting away at the same time. One thing I always liked about Warzone tanks and ships is the camera position, though I know that is not the case for everyone. But with the camera closer to your ship, they just look more impressive, and that adds a lot of immersion for me, when I have the feeling that the large warship I command really is large. If you are in a situation where you feel the ship is blocking your view though, which can happen on occasion, you just click the zoom key once, that's the zoom key not the binocular key, then it places the camera on top of the ship's mast and you have a clear unobstructed view all around, just a small tip. Though I prefer looking at the ship, it just looks cool. But anyway, let's talk about the gameplay. During this test we had US and German vessels available to play, and in the test the teams were mixed. I expect that to change for realistic battles, of course. Now, German and US will be the first naval tech trees to be added as far as I understand it, but Japanese, British and Italian ships were also already tested in previous tests, so I guess they are not far behind. The largest units in the game at the moment are, as mentioned, light cruisers, Omaha class for the United States, and the Emden, that's the 1920s Emden, not the World War I SMS Emden, for the Germans. Then we got few destroyers, Fletcher and Clemson for the US and Type 1936 class destroyers for the Germans, as well as the Elbing class, which would be the T-25 in World of Warships, as well as a few others. On top of that, both sides have a lot of different torpedo boats and similarly sized vessels, like gunboats and the aircraft gun barges and things like that to choose from, which brings up an obvious question. When you have light cruisers and tiny torpedo boats, and they are really tiny compared to a cruiser, in the same game, how will this be balanced? especially since Warsana tries to go for a slightly more realistic approach when portraying its units. Well, a small part of it are the maps, which is something I will talk about in a bit more detail later in the video. Anyway, currently we have a conquest mode with 3 capture points. One of them is more out in the open, while 2 are often hidden between islands, where there is a lot of cover and not much room to maneuver. That helps the repeater boats to even the odds a bit and gives them the opportunity to ambush and destroy even cruisers. However, overall destroyers and cruisers will still be much stronger than torpedo boats, even in those environments. So you need another system for balance. And the way that this is done at the moment is via a point system, similar to realistic battleground battles, or also similar to strategy games like Wargame Airland Battle or Red Dragon. At the moment you have 3 ship spawns, and you start out with a certain amount of points, and different units have different point costs to spawn them. Like, at the start of the battle you have 3000 points. A light cruiser, for example, costs 3000 points to spawn. Destroyers 2000 points, and torpedo boats and the like are free. Actions during the battle, damaging and destroying ships, capturing things and so on, gains you more of them. That means that theoretically, if you spawn in your cruiser first, if you have one, and then you get nothing done with it, you might not have enough points to spawn in a destroyer, and you have to spawn in a torpedo boat for both your other 2 spawns. Mind you, the way it was set up during this test, it was actually pretty hard to do bad enough in a cruiser not to be able to spawn in whatever you wanted afterwards, at least in my experience. In any case, if you spawn in a free torpedo boat first, you have the advantage that you can use the spawn points closer to the capture points and capture them first, giving your demon an advantage. Also, if you do well in this first free torpedo boat, you should gain enough points to use the biggest cruisers you can get with the other 2 spawns, no matter what happens. Something that was not possible in this test because there was only 1 cruiser per nation in the game. It should, however, be possible later, when there are more units in the game and you can set up your own crews with the ships you want. Again, similar to building a deck in Red Dragon, for example. Overall, I like this kind of system and I already liked it in Realistic Battle for Tanks. I think it has a lot of potential. But I also think it still needs quite a bit of fine-tuning and is, in my opinion, not going far enough. In ships and tank battles, by the way. The largest units should, in my opinion, be more expensive and there should be more difference in cost of units. At the moment, all destroyers are 2000 points. I think those point values should differ more and be better adjusted to the strengths of a particular unit. Because if you would do it more that way, you could also have units of the same general time frame in the same battle, even if they are of different strengths, with the spawn points making up for more or less powerful units in the same time frame. Currently that is not entirely the case. All ships considered destroyer size are 2000 points. The type 1936 I am in here, as well as the much smaller Albin class, aka the T-25. So you still need the battle rating to balance them, with the smaller Albin being lower in battle rating. But the Albin is also newer by a few years. So I would prefer it if it would be balanced more by a different spawn point cost instead. Now, in this weekend test, most larger units, destroyers, light cruisers and the like, were of a similar vintage, World War II era. Some were built in the 20s, but it is specifically stated that they were in their World War II configuration. With the smaller units we have, however, a mix of time frames, from World War II torpedo boats to boats from the 60s or even 70s. Now, we know that the tech tree will eventually go up past World War II. After all, we have Abrams and Leopard 2 tanks as top tiers for ground forces. And there is some really cool stuff in naval forces for post-World War II boats already. Like hydrofoil boats, which are great fun to blast around in, and things like that. However, I hope the mix of time frames with the small boats is just a testing thing and they will not mix it like that later on. Now that's just an immersion thing in realistic mode for me. Hydrofoil boats, as fun as they are, and Omaha class cruisers that were initially built in the 20s don't really mix. Now, overall I really like the concept of the spawn point system. It reminds me of similar systems in real-time strategy games I played, like Red Dragon. But it needs some fine tuning to be perfect. but that is the basics on how the game mode in the test works. Let's talk about the ship combat, starting with the guns. As you would expect, all the weapons on the ships work, even the depth charges, by the way. Usually you control the main guns and torpedoes and depth charges yourself, while the secondary and anti-aircraft guns are controlled by the AI, though you can take direct control of them as well if you want. You can order the AI gunners to focus on either naval targets, air targets or both, or stop firing altogether if you want to remain more hidden. The main armament you control from your binocular view, in what is somewhat a mix between direct aiming and being a gun director, which works quite well, and once you figure out how it works, it's quite easy. It looked harder in the videos that I have seen than it is. So let's talk about distance first. With the binocular view, you can point at the intended target, and the ship's range finders will then take a bit to measure the range to set target, and once they have done so, the guns will initially be set for this measured range. Mind you, there will be some error in this initial measurement, which it tells you in the binocular view. Now, this error will get smaller as you fire, and your crew can adjust the range estimate based on the shell impacts. Now, your guns will usually automatically set for the initial range, as I have just said, but from there you have to manually adjust your range, which you do with the mouse wheel. You see the number for the estimated range and the range set for the guns in the binocular view when you aim at the target. So when the range estimation changes because the target gets closer or further away from you, or the range estimation gets more accurate, you need to adjust the gun's firing range manually with the mouse wheel from the initial estimate as the range changes. Again, that sounds more complicated than it really is. You just set your guns for the range finder tells you. When the range comes closer, you adjust the range down. If it moves away, you adjust up. If you want to hit the target lower at the waterline, you adjust the range down. If you want to hit it higher at the superstructure, you adjust it up. So, elevation you set with the mouse wheel, which I kinda like. It gives the gunnery more of a naval gunnery gun director feel instead of a shooter feel, while still being very simple to do. Similar to the turn-based game Atlantic Battle, I would say. Now, that is for range. You will of course also have to set the horizontal lead. One important thing to keep in mind here is, especially if you come from World of Warships, you will have to take your own ship's speed into account when you lead your shots. So if your ship moves at 30 knots and you fire a broadside, the shells will inherit these initial 30 knots in that direction, and you have to account for that. So, if you aim at a stationary target while moving from left to right, you will have to aim to the left of the target to counter your speed to the right. Again, that sounds more complex than it is. It's pretty obvious when you play the game, as long as you don't forget that you have to do it. When you played Warzone before, you will be familiar with this, since it is also the case with tanks. Just that with tanks you rarely fire on the move until you hit the high tiers with stabilized guns, so you won't run into the issue as often. So overall, I like the aiming system. It gives you a bit of a feeling of directing gunfire rather than playing a shooter, while still being very simple and very easy to use as a system. I would go as far as to say maybe a bit too easy. One thing I would like to see is a bigger initial error with the range estimation and a slower adjustment for it. Since at the moment the error is small enough and the adjustment fast enough that you will usually get the range right at the second try at long range and on the first try at shorter ranges. Having a bigger error and slower automatic adjustment would give experienced players an opportunity to adjust for said error and range estimation themselves before the automatic does it for them. And I do like it if skill gets rewarded. But again, the basic system I like. And I also have to mention that the crews on the ships in the test were pretty much maxed out, so I don't know how much bigger the range estimation error would be for fresh crews. Still, even for full crews, I think that the initial range estimation error should be a bit higher than it is at the moment. So, that's a bit about firing and aiming guns. Let's talk about what happens when your shells reach the target. First, let's go over when ships count as destroyed. Now, a ship can be destroyed by either damaging it to such a degree that it counts as destroyed by destroying all of its sections, or by eliminating enough of the crew, If the ship loses enough crew, it counts as no longer combat capable and therefore destroyed. You can see the percentage of the crew in the target window up in the right corner. The crew status of the own ship is in the status screen in the left lower corner. Parts of the ships like weapons, machinery, fuel tanks, ammo storage and of course crew locations are modeled within the ship and can be hit and destroyed, depending on what it is, causing fires or secondary explosions as well. Blowing up an ammo storage is usually enough to destroy a ship, but not guaranteed. Furthermore, a ship can also sink. You don't see it that often, but I have seen it happen once. Usually torpedoes are what does most damage underwater and causes flooding, severe enough for ships to sink. That means that, as with tanks, the damage a shell does is not fixed, but depends on where and what it hits inside the ship. I wanted to mention that because it's important for the next part, because here we have one of the big differences to World of Warships I would like to discuss. Now, as I've said, I played World of Warships quite a bit and I do think it's a fun game, but being someone who likes his games having a little bit of realism, there are of course a few things I didn't like about it so much. And one of the big such issues is broadsides. One of the most well-known basic naval tactics in existence, I think, is crossing someone's T. I would guess almost everyone with even the most basic interest in a subject has heard of that. Crossing someone's T means that you cross in front of an enemy or behind, showing him your broadside, firing all your guns, while he can only fire his front or, if you cross behind him, his rear guns. Very well-known basic concept and, in World of Warships, literally the dumbest thing you can do. Again, I'm not complaining about World of Warships, there is a good reason why they do it this way, and for a game that is not that interested in any kind of realism beyond how the units look, it is also perfectly fine. Now, in comparison with that, in War Thunder Naval Forces, it's the other way around. Crossing someone's T does work quite well, and you want to avoid letting others cross your T. Let's go over quickly why this is the case. Let's get rid of the two obvious reasons first. If you show someone your broadside while crossing the T, you can fire all your guns and your enemy can't. Also, your armor, if you have any, is generally strongest on your broadside. But of course, the largest units currently in War Thunder are light cruisers, which means that a lot of the ships you get in the game at the moment are not armored at all. Destroyers, for example, are usually pretty unarmored, with the exception of some weak armor around the turrets and some basic splinter protection here and there. Now, in World of Warships, in comparison, all ships, including destroyers, are completely encased in armor. Thin armor in case of a destroyer, but armor nonetheless. That means that every ship, including destroyers in World of Warships, can bounce shells off their armored bows, assuming the caliber is small enough to not overmatch. I specifically mentioned that because I have seen both YouTubers as well as players in the test try to go for World of Warships style armor angling in War Thunder Destroyer vs. Destroyer combat. This will not work. War Thunder Destroyers are largely unarmored, as their real-life counterparts were, and the bow ship plating cannot bounce armor-piercing naval artillery shells at any angle. Light cruisers of course have more armor, but again, the bow of the ships is not usually made of armor and can again not bounce shells. Which leads to maybe not so obvious reasons for why you want to show your enemy your broadside. First, we have a very old concept, which is called raking fire. Now, that term is usually associated with sailing ships, but the concept does not simply stop applying at a certain point in time. With smaller and therefore tightly packed ships like destroyers and light cruisers, and at shorter ranges with the shells coming in at a flatter angle, the concept still applies. Even though you will probably not call it raking fire, as it is again generally associated with sailing ships. But what does it mean? Well, quite simple, the ship is longer than it is wide. If you fire through the bow or the stern of the ship with armor-piercing rounds, those rounds and the shrapnel caused by them have the entire length of the ship to fly through and do damage to equipment and crew on the way. While if you had the broadside of a thin destroyer or light cruiser, there is less space for the round to do damage before it and its shrapnels fly out the other side. With crew and equipment modeled inside the ship, this can make a very large difference. depending on the exact situation even more so than just having a generic overban and fullban, and again, the bow of those ships will not bounce armor-piercing shells. Here we're going to have an example for this. I get the opportunity to cross an enemy Fletcher-class destroyer's T, as he is focused on another target, in my 1936-type destroyer, firing armor-piercing rounds through his bow at extremely short ranges. First, you can see what happens if you forget to adjust for your own ship's speed, but after getting hits, if you take a look at the enemy's status display in the right upper corner, you can see the shells and the shrapnel they cause pass through about half the length of the ship and doing massive damage to the crew and equipment on the way. Now, some might now wonder, don't those armor-piercing rounds have a bursting charge and explode? Well, yes they do. But an armor-piercing round has a relatively small explosive filler in a very heavy shell, which won't just completely disintegrate. You still have lots of heavy armor-piercing shrapnel from the shell going in the general direction it went before it exploded, kind of like an armor-piercing shotgun blast. So don't try World of Warships style armor angling in those ships. You just give your opponent the opportunity to fire armor-piercing shells through the entire length of your ship, doing lots of damage to your equipment and crew, while you yourself can't use all your guns to fire back. Now, this is for shorter to mid-range fights. If the distance is long enough, the plunging fire will change that to a degree, as the shells come down at a steep angle, but even versus long-range plunging fire, it is usually better to have the broadside pointing at the enemy. Because, as mentioned, the rangefinder has a certain error. The larger the range, the larger this error is as well. So let's say you fire at long range at a target that is 100 meters long and 10 meters wide. If you have an error of overall 100 meters in your range estimate, and you aim for the middle of the target, and let's assume you get the horizontally correct, so only your vertical range estimate counts. Well, if the ship is pointing at you, it's 100 meters long and you have an error of 100 meters overall. Well, you will hit it even if you are 50 meters off. While, if the enemy shows you his broadside, you have to hit a 10 meter wide target instead of a 100 meter long target, so being only 25 meters off will mean you miss. That is of course for long range shooting where the shells come down the steep angle, the steeper the more the range error matters. In War Thunder, of course, you often fight at much shorter distances. I think the longest engagement I had so far in the test was 12 to 13 kilometers, which for a light cruiser is decent enough. But most fights are around 3 to 5 kilometers. That's lower than most of the two naval battles were fought at, but certainly not entirely unheard of for lighter units. Especially with destroyers, there were engagements that were at very close distances in reality as well. And while we are talking about a few differences between War Thunder and World of Warships, you of course can't go invisible in War Thunder to help you disengage from a fight. Something to keep in mind. However, pretty much every ship in the game at the moment can lay a smoke screen, so if you want to disengage, you need to use the smoke to do it. It will take away your and your allies' view as much as the enemy's, of course, so be careful when you use it. Well, another factor that determines how much damage you do is your choice of ammunition, of course. Armor-piercing or high explosive are the choices you have at the moment. To be honest, the few games I have played so far are not enough to give a definitive answer on what is the best in what situation. But so far I found that it is usually best to fire armor-piercing at light cruisers. For destroyers I use high explosive at the broadside and armor-piercing when I can rake the bow or the stern. That seems to work okay. For smaller targets it's always high explosive. But that will of course also depend on what type of shells we will get. For tanks there is a large variety in game, but since I have not seen the tech tree or upgrade tree yet, I don't know what we will get for the ships. One thing that would matter, for example, would be if it is a nose fuse or a base fused high explosive shell, with nose fused exploding an impact while base fused can have a certain penetration before they explode. But we will see later down the line when we see what kind of ammunition we get. Now, let's talk about the maps we currently have. As I said in the beginning, we have at the moment a pretty standard conquest game mode in this test with 3 capture points, with one usually more out in the open for the bigger units to fight over and 2 more hidden between islands, which are better suited for smaller boats. Cruisers and destroyers can get to them as well, but it will restrict their maneuverability. So far the maps are pretty small though, and I'm fairly certain they are made with arcade in mind rather than realistic battles. That would be in line with Wars on the Ground Forces, where the first maps in the closed beta were also pretty small and optimized more for arcade, like Karelia for example, with larger maps added later that are better suited for RB and SB. I would expect larger maps with RB in mind to be added later for the ships too. For the game mode itself, I think it still needs some work. I'm not sure if this conquest mode in its current form is that well suited for naval warfare in realistic battle. On the one hand, spawns are pretty close together, so ships can fire at each other pretty quickly. On the other hand, with ships not being that fast, it can often be hard to get from one capture point to the other in time to still matter. I think eventually it would be better to come up with something completely new for naval warfare, at least in realistic battles. Though the conquest game mode works well enough for now, I guess, when focus is more on testing the ships and ship versus ship combat. And the ship combat I think is quite fun at the moment. Overall, I like ships in War Thunder so far. It's still rough around the edges and needs some improvements and adjustments here and there, as one would expect from a closed beta, but I have fun with the ships, and I really hope we will eventually see even larger ships in it as well. Well, that was a bit of a look at War Thunder Naval Forces from the last pre-closed beta test, and this is it for this video. I hope it was informative, thanks for watching, and maybe I'll see you next time.